Welcome to the National Lesbian and Gay Writers Conference, held October 8th through the 10th, 1993 in Boston, Massachusetts. We now join our speakers as the session is just beginning.
Chrystos and Cheryl have agreed to share with us about their lives as writers, coming to us initially in this bridge called My Back, and taking their lives of very kind of fundamental specificity, lives as poets, as women of color, as Menominee Indian, as African American, and opening them up to us in this bridge so we could find ourselves at least as women of color and lesbians of color. And this morning, they'll talk about their lives now and writing now and what writing and politics and being open about sexuality and about what they believe, how they believe the world should be, what that means to them, and how that's changed over time. So thank you, and just take it away.
Thank you. I guess we have to use these, right? Good morning. Thank you for coming. Still a little early for some of us. Not me.
It's very early for me. This is the middle of the night.
Chrystos and I realized that, you know, though we had we known each other's work and we had written quite a bit over the last more than 10 years, and we've been in the same venues, but we never really met. So we met this morning for the first time. I mean, you know, really formally for the first time. But actually, I have forgotten. I never felt like we'd never met in the flesh, you know. So here we are, and we're happy to be here. What we had talked about doing is sort of alternating between our own conversation and yours with each other and with us, I suppose.
Yeah, it is.
And we thought we might start off by talking about what we've been doing since this bridge called My Back. Because both of us sort of officially came out as writers in that publication in 1981.
I think, yeah. You want me to go?
Before this bridge called My Back, I identified myself as Menominee, and the term woman of color made me very uncomfortable. I'm still actually a little nervous about that term because it feels to me as though it's a term that has been imposed by the feminist movement rather than a term that we ourselves have developed. I'm not really a woman of color. I am a Menominee, nation's woman, and that identity is primary to me. But the good part about thinking about being a woman of color meant that there were many, many other women that I had community with. And the effect of this bridge on Call My Back has been really profound on my career as a writer and on my sense of identity. I would not have probably gone to a woman of color meeting before this bridge called My Back. So it's really, sometimes now I'm not supposed to go because some people define it as black women, but one of the things that this bridge meant in my life as a writer was that I had ground. I had a place to be. Before that, I did a lot of oral readings and had a reputation in San Francisco But it wasn't until I did This Bridge Called My Back that universities started giving me lots of money sometimes to read poetry. not frequently enough, but some. And what it did, besides changing my identity, it also altered my perception of what writing could do. I had felt pretty lonely in terms of my writing. A lot of people call my writing angry. And in This Bridge Called My Back, I felt like I had a beautiful matrix of other women's anger. I wasn't just this angry person sort of beating a brick wall by myself. And I came to understand how, even though racism works differently in each of our lives, there is a common thread in it. And I suppose that thread, I've unraveled enough to understand that the chief effect of racism is loss of self-esteem, so that when you're under fire from racism constantly, in order to feel like you have the right to write at all, you have this continual battle that you're doing all the time because the society wants to shut you up, particularly if you want to talk about racism, which is one of the verboten subjects, like sex, which I think is very interesting. But it's verboten for anyone powerless to talk about racism or sex. It's not verboten, of course, for the dominant ruling class to talk about it. So for me, This Bridge Called My Back was the first time that someone said, you're a writer. And it was one of the most powerful readings I've ever done was at the University of Washington, in California, Santa, what was it? Down south. And it was a reading that I did with other members of This Bridge Called My Back. And what we did was appear on stage and read one another's works. So I wasn't necessarily reading my words and someone else wasn't, you know, and it was real. We did a performance, actually. And it was really very powerful and moving to see how my words could be read by an Asian American woman and have complete validity. You know, that was a very, really opened up my mind and helped me understand that when we write about the particular as well as we can, that particular is also the universal. So I think that's enough for me.
Weren't you in lesbian poetry?
What?
Weren't you in lesbian poetry?
Ellie and Joan's book, Lesbian Poetry.
Oh, okay, I'm just asking.
I don't remember. There were a lot of lesbians in that book.
No, This Bridge Called My Back was the first one.
Okay. I was in lesbian poetry. But,
well.
Not my lesbian poetry, though.
I suppose This Bridge Called My Back produced similar experiences for me as a black lesbian as for Chrystos. It gave me a sense of community. I had a similar reaction, I suppose, to the term women of color because I felt it collapsed distinctions. But I also was very excited by the idea of being in dialogue with other women, women of color writers. I also felt that sometimes I was critical of, I felt critical that it didn't identify lesbians more in the title, since many, 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 many of the women writing in the book were lesbians, but that was okay too, since it was a very, 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 very out text in much of the writing. It also encouraged me, we were talking this morning about how this bridge changed our writing and our writing process. It also encouraged me to write more poetry. none of my poetry at that point was in this bridge. It was that essay, Lesbianism, an Act of Resistance. And I must say that though some of the opinions expressed in that particular article, I would definitely change, some soften, some mute today. That essay has really sort of dogged me for the last... I didn't say dogged, it has like haunted me for the last... ooh, my coffee. Has haunted me for the last, I'll say 10 or 12 years, because as you must know, this bridge is still a very, very big seller for women's studies courses, for many women's studies courses, and many students who read it, you know, because I work at Rutgers, come up to me and many times take me to task for that essay. I mean, I've been invited to classes to come and sort of defend it. So it's all rather fun, you know, especially now that bisexual people have more of a voice. They often want to, you know, which is fine, they often want to challenge some of my comments about, that one comment I made about bisexual people in that article. It's amazing to me how, it's still amazing to me how much of a community that book still creates, and how useful it still is. For me as a writer, and for younger generations of women, feminists. I guess that's all I want to say. About this bridge called my back. We also wanted to talk about, Also, Angela Bowen. No, that's not Angela, I'm sorry, it's Jackie. We also wanted to talk about writing process.
Yeah.
And that's a conversation I suppose we would like to involve anyone in the audience in also.
One of the things that I think it's important to say, because I've had some people ask me questions or say things to me here that sort of startled me, the expectation that the minute you start writing you'll get published is crazy. As a matter of fact, I read poetry publicly for 10 years. That means every single women's benefit that happened in the Bay Area, every single jail rally, every single everything, I read and read and read and read for no money, paid my own transportation. So it's important, I think, to understand that there's a lot of dues you pay before you get published, particularly if you are a lesbian, and particularly if you are a lesbian of color. In case you haven't noticed, reviews of our work don't appear regularly in the New York Times review of books. And to some extent, we're not even properly addressed, I believe, in the queer press. That's maybe a nasty comment, but it's true. So I guess that for those of you who are writing now and haven't yet been published, I'd like to say that the way you get published is that you keep writing and keep sending work out and keep reading until you're ready to kill somebody, and then it might happen. And I'm not sure how much being published has to do with being a good writer. I think that's very important to understand. There is certainly 100 million people being published in this country who are writing absolute crap, and I don't even know why they're cutting down the trees to do it. So, so that issue of being published can destroy your life as a writer if you focus on it. If your whole focus is getting published, then you're at the mercy of all of the people who have the power to publish you. And it's much healthier. Even myself now, my issue when I'm writing is not who's going to publish this, but what do I need to say? And as long as you keep focused on your own voice and what it is that you need to say, then you sort of stay in a more sane place in terms of writing. There's not very many lesbian publications now that publish out lesbian work. Or I'm not that sure about gay men's writing, although I think the James White Review is a pretty out gay men's magazine. Because there's so few places for you to get published in anthologies and little small magazines, it makes it harder to get a book published. Because generally speaking, when a publisher is looking at your work, they want to know who else has published you, who else has been crazy enough to print what you had to say. And and they look at things like how well you are known in the world. So I suggest then that you do readings at rallies and readings every place that you can get a reading, and even organize things yourself, take it over. And another suggestion I have is to produce broadsides, which are fairly cheap. You can usually get a really nice typeset broadside, which is one poem on a piece of paper, for about $250, 500 copies. So if you produce a broadside, you take it to bookstores and it sells for a dollar or whatever, you're not really making money on it, but your name is getting out in the world. The other thing is, I have this suspicion that editors come to know your name because they've seen it before, okay? So this means if you send stuff out and they reject it, send it somewhere else, and then send it back again, and just keep sending it, and pretty soon they'll come across a piece and they'll say, Chrystos, I think I've heard that name before, or something. Well, we better look at this, we better read it. So that's one of the ways to kind of manage things to your advantage. I want to make it very clear that I don't make a living as a writer, so keep your day jobs. And probably you'll have to keep your day jobs for the rest of your lives. I have very good royalties on my books. I make about a dollar a book. That's actually pretty high for some publishers. So you can imagine how many thousands of books you need to sell in order to live. Unless you're writing naiad romance novels, I would say that you probably can't live off of your writing. And I'm actually not sure if anybody writing those does live off their writing. And since I'm a literary snob, I don't really have much to say about those. But what are the things that I think it's also important to understand is that rejection is sometimes nothing to do with you. So therefore, people who get submissions have cramps. They break up with their lovers. Their lovers break up with them. Their lovers sleep with their best friends. They have no money to put out the new issue. They have to do a benefit for the new issue. I mean, lots of stuff. Just like everything happens in your life, everything happens in theirs. So the day that they're looking at submissions, if you're talking about breaking up with your lover and they don't want to deal with it, so it's important to remember that rejection isn't necessarily about whether you can write or not. It's also, there's all these human elements that nobody ever cops to. and friendship networks is the other part that nobody cops to. Generally speaking, what happens is your friends are the ones who like your work and they publish you. So I got published in This Bridge Called My Back because Barbara Cameron took my work to Gloria and Zaldúa, and so she really loved it. So it's kind of like you have to find allies for your work and sort of establish friendship networks. It's kind of like being in a corporation, although I'm sure publishers would deny that. The other part of all of that is that getting to your own voice is extremely difficult in this culture because all of us have received so much brainwashing about who we are, what a lesbian is, what a person of color is, what a white person is. And all of that brainwashing is constant. It doesn't ever stop. So what ends up happening is you really have to spend time alone. That's the bad news about being a writer. If you want to become a good writer, you spend a lot of time by yourself, lonely, crying, coughing, spilling coffee on things, being crabby, walking around in circles, staring out the window, sharpening pencils, hating yourself. It's like the image of a writer who just sits down and reels out this stuff is completely false. I don't know any writers who do that. Everybody I know who writes, everyone I'm close to, will call you at 3 o'clock in the morning, I can't get this damn book to go. And, you know, you meet someone in the halls here, and some of the people that I'm friends with, you know, they'll be crying because they're struggling with a book and they can't get it to move. So that's common. That's what it's like. Writing is not an easy birth. It's pretty complicated. Sometimes it takes cesarean sections and lots of drugs, you know, and stuff like that. So I don't recommend drugs, but some people need drugs in order to write. So there's a lot of myths about writing that I feel completely obliterate what writing is about. It's a very lonely process, and it's very scary. Every time I've written something, every time I've published a book, I've been terrified of what the response will be. You know, are people going to hate it? Are they going to love it? Will this mean I'll never write again? You know, lots of stuff. Mm-hmm. And generally speaking, when you finish a book, you sort of drop into this hole and feel like shit and like dying. It's the end of the world, and you're not ever going to write again. But you just have to kind of roll with that and realize that it passes. It's kind of like cramps or depression, you know. It's just, you just have to take a hot bath and wait for it to be over. Because eventually somebody will do something that will irritate you enough to write again. I think of writing very much like the pearl in the oyster, you know. It's like someone gets grit under you and then you write, you know, and... And sometimes the grit can be beauty. I mean, you know, sometimes something will just wipe you out. The main thing I think to do as a writer is to just be still and concentrate on being there in yourself, which is hard to do. This culture teaches us to be constantly distracted. So we have the TV going and the radio going, and we're cooking food and talking to a friend on the telephone and ironing a shirt, right? And if you behave like that, you don't get to the writing place. You know, you really have to do sit down and think and feel and all that uncomfortable stuff. I recommend that you write things by hand and not work directly with a computer. Now, I know a lot of people disagree with me, but I find that the mind is not set up to the rhythm of a computer. And I believe that CRT screens affect your brain waves. And that sometimes when people are working on a computer screen and they have writer's block, if they'll just turn away and write with a pen and paper, they won't have writer's block anymore. So, and sometimes if you go for a walk, you pray. I mean, one of the things that I do a lot when I'm trying to write is pray. Pray that it's going to come out right. Pray that I'll figure out what it is I need to say. See, it's early in the morning, so I'm still in semi-dream states. I think I've said enough, right? Yeah.
I think my process is quite different. But I think a big part of my process over the last, I guess since 1981, has been involved, becoming involved in Conditions, Conditions magazine. And that also created another real community of writers with whom to communicate, and a real sense of community. We talked about this yesterday in the workshop on called Queer Poetry, Past, Present, Future. It was listed as the poetic tradition in your programs. But we talked about mentoring and the creation of the writing community as quite critical to lesbian and gay writing. So that was a big part of my, I think, and still continues to be, a big part of my writing process, because I made a connection between the kind of writing that I was, that we all were, I was a member of a collective. Actually, one of the founding editors is here right now, Ellie Balkin. And I work with conditions from 81 to 90. And that, as I said, you know, it helped me to it broke down what Chrystos was talking about is a real isolating habit of writing, or the isolating process of writing, the isolated process of writing. So, and it encouraged me to write because I had sort of a touchstone. You know, I could see what women, what lesbians were interested in writing about, and what we were interested in reading. And it helped me frame my own writing projects. I guess one of the big issues for me is this kind of contention and process with the audience, and really attempting or trying to reach for and find out what the lesbian, and I suppose I mean that term in its broadest and narrowest sense, wanted to read or wants to read. And I think I still pretty much do that. I mean, I can't go over the particulars of my process because I really don't even know it myself. I just like write. I know there's certain times when I write, you know, certain months when I write, certain times when I feel I have to get stuff out. I'm constantly on top of deadlines and extending them and whatnot. I mean, you know, like, you know, I never get anything. Pardon me? Well, I'm a reciprocal kind of gal, so, you know, I'm on top of them, and they're on top of me. Yeah, right, they're on top of me. I don't think about it. I don't think about it being an isolating process. You know, I just think about it as primarily a service. Something that I got to do. Computer. I like computer.
I do. I have a different kind of, particularly with prose types of things.
I still do write, but you know, I lots of times will just like really go to that word processor because you know it. It really, it's a stimulating process for me. For me, as much as I can use music, computer, ironing, cooking. I don't bake bread. I know that's a big thing with lesbians, bread, baking. I use it. But I think I do really feel that community and being in touch with community helps stimulate that process for me. To say nothing of, I mean, you don't even have to really talk about, you know, obviously reading. As a poet, obviously reading is an essential kind of a process for me. Helps a lot and helps to break down that isolation. Could other people ask questions or start to talk or, you know, reflect or whatnot, you know, if you feel like it, if it's not too early for some of you? Because it's kind of a, yeah, sure.
I was really happy that you started your book. The book is Bridge, and I think of other anthologies like Homegirl, and yesterday you were talking about the queer poetry, the poetic tradition. And I just wondered if each of you could talk a little bit about what it's like to be a poet anthologized in a mixed genre anthology. We know how to problem because we want that poetry to be out there, but mixed gender and mixed politics and cross-cultural anthologies, they've been very important to me, and I wondered what it was like for you to have your form in conversation with other forms, you know, as kind of both of learning and a defining of those forms.
I'll go first, because I got... I've been having, actually, some very serious doubts about being in any more anthologies, because I have been betrayed so many times in those kinds of situations. For instance, often I'm the only Native writer represented in an anthology, and I'm not going to accept that anymore. I recently had someone write to me and want to reprint some of my poetry in this anthology, and I wrote back and said, if I'm the only Indian woman in this book, I'm not doing it. And because there are other out Native lesbian writers now published, so there's no excuse for me to be the only one. And I have been in situations where I thought someone was very conscious and agreed to be in their anthology, and then discovered that it was primarily white people, that not all ethnic groups were represented, that disabled women weren't representative. In other words, that my own politics were not present in the anthology, which can be very embarrassing when your best friend says to you, how come you're in this damn thing and there's no Asian women in it? You know, and it's like, so, you know, anthologies are very troublesome, and particularly because oftentimes someone will write you 3 months before they're due to print something and say, can we reprint this? And so then you're all wrapped up in their flurry and their pressure, and I sometimes have forgotten to ask those very important kind of questions. Who else is in this anthology? What is the political focus behind this? Because it does make you look bad as a writer, I think, if you end up being an eternal token. And there were no other Native speakers invited to this conference, for instance. I'm it. And of course, I feel very strongly about that. And I also understand that there's money and, you know, there's time constraints and there's organizational problems and all the rest of that. But because in my own community, it's like the queer community isn't really my community. I am queer, and I participate in it, but very much on the fringes. My community is Native people, and almost all of my political organizing happens in the Native community. When I go to Native events, everybody knows I'm queer, and it's just a very different experience than this. I, you know, at this conference, I felt very lonely and strange and kind of weird and at odds, and we have a different way of dealing with things in the Native community. It's like it's not just that we're a different ethnic group. We have a different worldview, so that we all eat together. None of us have eaten together at this conference. When you come into town, someone meets you at the station, and they say to you, this is your room, this is where you're going here, if you need anything, here's my phone number, call me. We have just a whole different kind of way of dealing with each other, because relationship is the core of our way of looking at the world. So I'm often, you know, really uncomfortable in the queer world, because it doesn't, it's not comfortable. It's kind of alienating, and that's sad to me. I would love to be able to figure out a way to bring the way my people treat me into the queer world, but there's a lot of resistance to that because of racism and all the rest of it. So anthologies have become really sticky for me. And like Cheryl, there's often times when you've written a poem 20 years ago, and you know, someone wants to reprint it now, and it's like it embarrasses you now, you know, and it's like you kind of say, well, can I please give you something new, you know, because maybe you don't agree with what you wrote 20 years ago. I mean, that's one of the biggest difficulties of being a writer, is that just like a snake, you shed skins constantly, you know, you're changing all the time, and what you wrote 10 or 20 years ago sometimes is mortifying, you know, and, you know, sometimes people come up and say, oh, I love this that poem, and you go, oh, my God, thank you. there's a lot of problems in anthologies, and in terms of awareness, or in terms of, for instance, there's been two lesbian magazines, I won't mention names, that recently did class issues, okay, issues of class. Both of those magazines had only white women writing about class. Now, as far as I'm concerned, that's criminal in this day and age. You know, it's like, and I also understand that I was too lazy to send an article in about class. You know what I'm saying? It's like I had all these other things that I was working on. So, I mean, sometimes writers are at fault in that too, you know, because certainly people have bugged me for a year and a half sometimes, or I think actually someone bugged me for 2 years to send them something. So, no, it's really that I have too many, I'm wearing too many hats, yeah, is what right. The problem is. But although I do have lazy moments. So I think that if you're going to be in an anthology, it's really important to ask those kinds of questions. You know, who else is in it? What is your political focus for this? What is the reason for the anthology? And the other little thing that you should know about an anthology is normally you get paid 50 to 200, and 200 is like rare, max once every 10 years, or nothing to be in an anthology. So your focus is, I feel, much more as a writer to make your own books, because then at least you get a dollar a book. I'm sorry to be so, you know, monetary about this, but I'm working class, you know. And so, you know, anthologies, generally speaking, you know, if you're not published at all, it's a way to start, because people will then know your name and things like that. But most of the time, anthologies don't go deep enough for me. I usually get really frustrated. You know, a prime example is the book Naming the Violence, which is still the only book on lesbian battering, unfortunately. Lesbian battering is a very important issue to me, and it's very common. And so is emotional abuse and all that kind of stuff. And that still remains the only anthology about this very important subject. And from my point of view, that's a very shallow book. It just briefly touches on things. And I'm really interested as a writer and as a person in examining the dynamics of abuse, how internalized homophobia and attitudes of class and race intersect to create abuse among us. Because one of the things that lesbians are doing as a revolutionary force in the world is that we're forging relationships with other people and other classes. That's not happening in the rest of the society. Heterosexual people very rarely step outside of their class backgrounds or their race backgrounds in order to engage with someone. And because we're an oppressed group and thrown all together, and, you know, it's like we all like pussy, so therefore, you know, that is really the only thing we have in common, right? We don't have anything else in common whatsoever. It's just liking pussy. And so that pushes us into getting into relationships and taking risks that we probably would not take if we were heterosexual. So that's, to me, like a really revolutionary part of lesbianism and a place where we could really find power if we could examine more closely how those dynamics, you know, I mean, we fight with one another a lot because of those aspects too, and get into things where you don't talk to somebody for 5 years and all that rot. But and that kind of stuff, I think, is abuse. So I would like to see ways in which we, in anthologies, go to a much deeper level instead of staying on the surface of things. So,
I wanted to go back to the issue of this bridge. One of the things I neglected to say about one of the lessons I learned from this bridge, for me, it allowed me to see that lesbian feminist communities, at least the one that was, I should like really be more specific, at least the lesbian feminist community where I live, New York. I don't live in New York, I live in New Jersey, but I interacted with in New York, Manhattan and Brooklyn, I think was one of the few places where there was a discussion, a conversation about race and class, ethnicity, all of those things, all of those issues that get rather fragmented and isolated, you know, rather fragmented in terms of the various communities that most of us are members of or identify with. So that was one of the ways that this bridge opened me up. It allowed me to begin to engage in a conversation about difference in a way that I hadn't before. To the question of anthologies, I have sort of a similar and an opposite reaction to Chrystos. I think that they are extremely important. I mean, I'm not saying you didn't say important. I think that they're extremely important as educational tools. Now, you know, certainly the quality of many of them is uneven, and certainly the quality of many that my work has been in has been uneven. But I feel that they're immensely important. And I do, I mean, I agree with Chrystos, you know. I do like to find out, you know, what audience the anthology or the work is intended for. Who else is going to be in the anthology? But I often do, I mean, in fact, just recently, have the experience of, you know, being the only whatever in the anthology. For instance, there's a book that's coming out of Rutledge called Theorizing Black Feminism. Well, I know that I'm the only lesbian in the anthology. And, you know, there are plenty of Afro-American lesbians out here. Or, you know, but I felt it was really important to be in that anthology and be in that conversation. So I suppose that at this point, you know, one of the things I feel that I have to be engaged in terms of my process of writing, my process of publishing, my process of extending myself, is to be in venues. This is why I think we were talking about this yesterday in the poetic tradition, that are different from the one or the ones I've been engaged in over the last, I think since 1981. What was the rest of your question? You said, as poets, you asked a specific question about.
One of my hopes for the kinds of anthologies like Bridge and World Girls, that they would have they're organized around political agendas or ideas. Now, I understand what you're saying about how.
Not necessarily.
But being organized around politics as opposed to genre, and, you know, how you felt that primarily poets being in anthologies that were more than poets, they were, you know,
oh, okay.
I don't distinguish poetry from personal narrative, from letter, from arts, from crafts. do you know what I'm saying? It's like I feel as though all of those definitions, you know, this is an essay, that's a poem, that's a novel, that is just fragmentation and a way to categorize something and to some extent, I believe, diminish it. Because what all creative work is an expression of the spirit, and that's like the central core issue, is what is this spirit expressing that we need to understand? And a lot of times in criticism that's done, the criticism will be not about the content or a response to the content, which to me is the most important part, but will be things about, oh, this character was one-dimensional, or what? Do you know what I'm saying? It's like, or there was too many adjectives in this, or whatever. So for me, my focus as a writer, although I play with alliteration, I know about all that stuff. You know, it's like I care about it. My focus is always content first, and I think that differentiates me from a lot of writers, particularly academic writers, whose focus is form first. And I think that, you know, in fact, there's a way in which academic writers look down upon content writers because we're too emotional or confessional, or I don't know, they have a lot of terms that they use to make it seem as though content is not important. But since I believe that if you don't have content, you don't have communication, and writing is communication, then what are you doing? You know, I mean, I've certainly read a million poems in my lifetime and could not tell what the hell they were saying. You know, it's like, what is she talking about? This is going on for 14 pages and I still don't know what it's about, you know? And there's lots of, you know, obscure images flying through and, you know, interesting stuff going on. And, you know, from a very form point of view, you can back off and go, that's interesting that she did that. But it's like, my attitude is kind of so what. I live very much in a very immediate sort of survival place in my culture. There's really no other place to live as an Indian person.
Please turn the cassette over to side two.
Place. I came to writing from a political place. It's like I started writing because I was an activist, not because I mean, I was always writing, you know, because I didn't have friends in school, but I was a nerdy kid, and I was also the only Indian in my school, so I got beat up by everybody. But writing was like this secret place where I went to sort of take care of all my wounds and write for 3 pages about what Betty Jo did to me, and you know, and then what happened. And I didn't become the writer I am now until I entered politics and started working politically to change the world. And that's when I really started feeling that push to be public about my writing. And I still have a division in my mind, not in form, but in that kind of content. You know, it's like there's personal bitching that you do to get through life, and then there's writing that you do for the world. And so I have volumes and volumes of personal bitching that go on for pages and pages about whatever fight I had with so-and-so. But I never publish that kind of stuff. And so I make my idea of how you separate writing is not about form so much, because I'm trying at the moment to write a novel, and I have a lot of respect for people who write novels, and I'm also working on a series of essays and all that, so I don't feel like writing needs to be so rigidly defined that you only write poetry or you only write essays or you only write a novel. Because to me, writing is a smorgasbord. You know, why shouldn't you eat everything on the table and do whatever it is you want to do? And in fact, I'm more interested in work in which form has been, it's like one of the things that's really exciting to me as a writer is in the last 10, 15 years, there are fewer and fewer once upon a time novels, which I find extremely boring. You know, it's like describing the furniture, describing this, describing that, you know, then they go to Boston, then they come home, you know, it's like, ugh. And I really like the kind of surreal writing that's coming out of South America. There's some very powerful writing coming out of Africa, some interesting stuff from Cuba. It's like, that's what I'm interested in, is people who are exploding the forms of Western literature and writing essays that are poetic and novels that are poetry and novels that are diaries. Alice Walker is particularly an interesting writer to me because she's, I think, very much in the forefront of people. And Audre Lorde also busting through form and doing something more interesting than, you know, sort of standard Western lit. I try very hard to read the old dead white boys, and I just really can't get through them, you know. They're just tedious. And so I'm interested in a form that's not defined yet. I'm trying to write stuff that actually isn't poetry anymore, because I find poetry confining too. So did I answer your question? Who knows?
Poetry. I have a different reaction. I still believe that poetry as a form is important. Well, yeah.
I didn't say that.
No, that's true. I guess what I'm saying is I still believe that it's important to define the form or what I'm writing in as poetry. Because as we were discussing earlier, poetry is sort of like, and I'll use Chrystos' metaphor, sort of like a homeland for both of us. Because both of us have worked pretty much. I mean, though we have written essays, both of us have worked. And I know I still work very much in poetry. In fact, all the time, you know, that's the form that I like to work in. And other things that I write, i.e. essays or articles, are labor for me. I back to the issue of poetry and anthologies, with other genre or other forms. I think that, it has been, I think that through lesbian feminist publishing and writing, we have seen both the heights and highs and lows of mixed genre production, you know. And I think that's one of the things one of the innovative things about our literature, you know, how many of our writers use different forms within a framework and produce anthologies or books in which different forms in and of themselves sort of conflate and come together, which I think is interesting.
Gloria Anzaldúa does that.
So it's okay. I mean, you know, being having my poems in, as long as they're not filler. I mean, like I had a poem in. Well, sometimes people do that. They say, let's break up this fiction with, you know, a few poems. And some, you know, some you don't have control over that, you know, how they're going to actually place, you know, your poem in their work, you know. I mean, I like the mixed genre anthologies, and I like you know, the ones that are just focusing on poetry. And if I'm interested in the perspective of the anthology or the work, whether it evolves around politics or the form. I mean, I have some work coming out in, hopefully it's going to come out, the woman's been promising that it's going to be out for the last 10 years. It's called A Formal Feeling Comes. And it's an anthology of poems by women who write in traditional forms, you know. And she accepted some of my work. I was interested in that because of the forms, because I am interested in formalism, and some of the forms that dead white boys use. Yeah. You gotta answer.
I am really blessed in my community because I guess it's kind of hard to explain. I come from an oral tradition where being able to speak is very, very important, and especially if you can speak for more people than yourself, is like that's the goal. So my writing has always had this goal of speaking not just for myself, but for more people than myself. And one of the things that has happened to me as a writer that people don't know about, it's like I don't get reviewed in the New York Times Review of Books or really in the queer media for that matter. And yet when I do a benefit reading for Leonard Peltier or Norma Jean Croy, people who are Native come up to me in the audience afterwards and say, thank you for your book, it saved my life. And to me, that's what I'm writing for. I want to save lives, literally. And I've had white women say that, black women, all you know, Asian women, Chicana women. It's like all different kinds of people have told me that my books have saved their lives in one way or another, because I would talk about something they didn't think it was okay to talk about, or that I would be angry about something that they had been told it was not all right to be angry about. And for me, that's really important. That's the best review that I can get. And I feel very loved by my Native community. For instance, not too long ago, I did a reading, and Dennis Banks said to me, you know, I want to introduce Chrystos. If we had an Indian Pulitzer Prize, she would win it, you know. See, we don't have Pulitzer Prizes that are Indian, and we don't have an Indian New York Times Review of Books. So, and it's like, and so being loved by my people and speaking for a lot of the issues, I think of myself as a bridge person because my mother's white, and I grew up in a culture learning how to deal with white people and all the stuff. I grew up in a city. And so I feel as though I have a very grave responsibility as a writer to bring the issues of my people, many of whom don't speak English at this very moment, into the wider world, into what they call the canon of American literature, which I find a very amusing phrase. I'm going to write a piece about the canon of American literature and how it's busy shooting us all to bits. But so I feel as though the love of my people sustains me through a lot of stuff that's really hard. And I think that I'm particularly lucky because I don't get a sense that in other communities there's that same kind of love and honor for, I would say particularly that I don't feel as though white people as a whole, this is a generalization and I don't mean it to be nasty, but I don't feel as though they understand how to love one another. And that's very sad to me. I think a lot of what racism is about is unloved people looking for someone to hate. And that's a very complex kind of interaction. So I'm always conscious that racism is as painful for white people as it is for me. Standing outside of the mainstream literature, I mean, when you're a woman who is a lesbian and who is native, there's no way that you're ever going to, I mean, I know that the New York Times Review of Books is never going to review me. Never am I going to be accepted as a serious poet. When I get asked to go to colleges and get paid $2,000, the students are the ones who organize the readings. An English department has never invited me to come and read poetry. Never. It's always the students. It's the ethnic studies students. It's the black women's studies, whatever. So it's like, it's really clear to me that that's my audience or that's my place and that's where I draw my nourishment from. And I don't even think about the New York Times Review of Books. I mean, I'm bringing that up because I see myself as real separated from that world, even though I read it, you know, because I generally find that whatever they review negatively is a book I will want to read. So it's like they trashed the hell out of Alice Walker's new book and it was like, I better go get that, you know. So, you know, they're kind of a good barometer in that way for what's good to read. What was the second part of your question? I forgot. I'm sorry.
What do you consider
good? I would say that whatever speaks from the heart. Not that you don't need craft, too. Craft is very important. It's very important to understand things like alliteration and metaphor and all that kind of stuff, you know. But you don't need to go to a creative writing class for that. You know, you can pick up, there's a couple of handbooks. One is a woman named Babette Deutsch. It's a pretty good little book. You know, it has all the forms in it. You can figure out how to write a sestina, which I particularly love, but which was not invented by white men. It was invented by a dead white woman who never married. So I'm convinced she was a dyke. What's her name? Victoria Colonna developed the sestina in Italy. Long, long time ago. So, and it's important to know form, and I read other poets voraciously and frequently say, damn, I wish I'd written that line. So I think that that's a really good way to figure out what quality writing is. What speaks to you, what's interesting to you, what catches your eye. I think everyone in this room would have a different favorite poem to put forward, you know, because it's very subjective. Writing is completely subjective. It's like if a person is an incest survivor, they could read something that's really poorly written about incest and think it's the best thing in the world because it helped them understand something about themselves. So writing, you know, the academic way of looking at writing is what is the form, you know, what does this reference? They always like to have those little Latin quotes that they never translate, so you don't know what the hell it says. You know, it's like there's this whole, you know, footnotes and all that kind of stuff that goes along. I feel as though academia has posited that this is writing, and I'm saying that we, the people, are writing. This is what it is. And if you look back in history, you can see originally only very, very wealthy aristocracy people knew how to read and write. It's like none of us in this room, you know, 500 years ago would read and write.
We would not have access to that. That movie Yentl that Barbara Streisand did, when the scene when she's learning to read in secret and her father is teaching her to read, I'm getting chills just now thinking about it, because literacy for women is very, very recent. And literacy for people of color is very, very recent. You know, and you can't have writing until you have literacy. You have to be able to read so that you can write. And so particularly for Native people, it's, you know, we just last summer had our first ever Native Writers Conference. That's how new all of this is for us. So it's so I am a mentor to many, many young Native writers, not just lesbians, but young men. And it's really important to me to sort of get lots and lots and lots of people writing. I mean, that's my idea. The more people that write, the more we change what writing is. And that's really important to me, because I don't want to be coming back here as a spirit in 500 years and find that Shakespeare exists and Alice Walker has disappeared and Audre Lorde has disappeared and et cetera. You know, I really want us to change the face of the world, because we still have people. There's a guy that wrote a nasty article in the New York Times Review of Books about multiculturalism. And I can't remember that many quotes from it, but his whole idea was that culture is the Greek and Roman myths, and it is Shakespeare, and everything else is just sort of like pickles on the side, and to suggest that literature can be anything else than these things is to demean literature. So that's a very intense kind of, you know, position, and many, many academic people still hold that idea, even though they themselves do not speak Greek or Latin.
I speak Latin. Pretty much, you know, V, I'll just, you know, I feel pretty blessed myself. I think the reception of my work has been very positive, and I've received a lot of positive feedback from community. Pardon me? I'm sorry. Oh, use the mic. You can't hear me, Jackie. I'm only teasing Jackie. So it's been very positive to me, and it really keeps me going. As Chrystos said, you know, what is good writing is a really subjective process. I mean, I can only talk about what I like, you know. And I guess I will have to refer back to my experience on the editorial collective of Conditions magazine, you know, where we did, you know, place an emphasis not only on writing by lesbians, but on what we called good writing. And that meant an attention to the craft, and a kind of, authenticity in the projection of the ideas, and a certain kind of politic about the presentation. So, I mean, I guess those things are roughly what I consider good writing. We could get into my favorite authors, which, you know, I don't think people want to hear. I don't want to get into. But my interest in literature, is also an interest in particular. I'm particularly interested in Afro-American literature historically and currently. So, I mean, that's been my interest for at least 20 years. And continues to be an interest of mine. And so I sort of don't look at it in terms of what I like and don't like, but in terms of what it tells me about the process and the progress of Afro-Americans through the literature, beginning perhaps, well, not just perhaps, beginning with Phyllis Wheatley through the slave narrative. So that's really, you know, really where my interest in literature almost begins and ends. Doesn't end there, but it certainly begins there. Certainly, that's certainly a very strong place for me. I have to really often struggle to get myself outside of it. I I think I have to say that in terms of the environment I work in every day, the university environment, I must say that a lot of what we can, you know, what that which we can. A lot of that is changing. I mean, a lot of it's the same, but a lot of it is changing. You know, unfortunately, what we do get to see in the New York Times are the anti-multiculturalists and the so-called anti-PC people, you know, who, you know, anyway, that's, but there were other hands.
Okay, please, because it's cool.
My father is an assimilationist. He's very opposed to my writing, as is my whole family. Their belief is that I'm just going to get myself killed. Why don't I shut up? And they might be right. How I came to that, because I'm still at this point struggling with identity. I've gone into women of color events where people didn't know me, and because I'm light-skinned, I've been told to get out. So that all of that pain about being a half-breed and about where is your identity, and particularly for people who are white and Indian, because these aren't just two different races, these are colonizer and conquered. So when you're a breed, you're carrying around almost the history of this country in your body, that pain. And I deal with that by writing. And there's a woman in Seattle who's doing an anthology of breed women. And one of the issues for us, of course, is that often, even if we're full blood, we're adopted out into white homes. And so we grow up not knowing our nation, no connection, not knowing anything at all. So there's a way people has made most native people
almost like lost children. And that's, you know, my belief about why we have such an alcohol problem is that the pain that we're carrying around in our bodies is so intense that you can't, almost you can't stand it without doing something. I was only able to stop drinking when I was writing all the time. That, I mean, it's like, and I still want to drink sometimes. So what I think of that pain as is if we can write about that pain and bring it out into the world and examine how our personal pain reflects this worldwide pain, really, because it's my belief that's what's happening with the earth, is that there's indigenous peoples of all kinds. African people are indigenous people, and they have been colonized just as we have been colonized. And so as we can look at the whole worldwide picture of colonization and what it means, how it has impacted every single person, you know, and how when you turn the world into a shopping mall so that you go to Costa Rica to go on a vacation and you go to Hawaii to buy a this and a that, you know, it's like when the world becomes a shopping mall, then what happens is that we're attacked. You know, it's like we're in the way of the world becoming a more efficient shopping mall, if you see that. And so I try to do a lot of political work because I believe that as a breed person, I have an even greater responsibility to do political work than someone who is full blood, because I have an access to the dominant culture and I can sort of like get some kind of understanding of what it's up to. So that's how I solve my pain, is being very, very politically active in lots and lots of stuff, you know. And it takes me too long to go through the whole list, but so and the issue of being light-skinned in the world when that's not who you are is one that it's very complicated, because being light-skinned, I didn't get beat up as much in school as my brother did, who was darker skinned than I am, because that's one of the things about mixed race families is some kids are darker, some kids are lighter. And so I found that my brother, who got beat up more than I, doesn't feel comfortable writing or reading or speaking. You know, there's things that happened to him in his life that have made it impossible for him to be me. So I always keep that in mind, that there is in this country a very clear, to me anyway, skin color stuff going on. So that the darker a person is, the more likely it is that the cab driver will scream at them, some obscenity at them, the more likely they'll be get beaten to death on a Portland street in broad daylight, which happened to an Ethiopian man. It's like skin color in this country is something nobody wants to talk about, and it's what almost everything functions around. If you look at the people in this hotel employed here, the maids and the maintenance people are brown people. The people at the front desk, for the most part, are white people. Okay? This is happening. This is institutionalized racism right in this very place where we have paid a lot of money to be. You know, so in some ways we're kind of cooperating with that, you know, and I don't know of any hotel where that's not true. So, you know, so all this kind of stuff about skin color privilege is that I feel it's very important for me to acknowledge that I escape a lot of shit in the world because I'm light-skinned. And so I feel, therefore, I have a responsibility to name all the stuff, you know, and to not let that privilege co-opt me. And it's really easy to want to, if you can, blend into the white world. I mean, they have more money, they have more privilege, they have more stuff, they're safer, you know. It's like, you know, I remember recently someone said to a friend of mine, and Rosie is Puerto Ricana, "Rosie, you have such beautiful skin. I would give anything to be a woman of color." And Rosie's a very sweet person, and so she came to me and said, "What should I say to this person?" You know, and I said, "Well, why didn't you punch her out?" You know, which would have been my reaction. I mean, I wouldn't have punched her out, but I would have with words. And so that all that stuff is going on, you know, where to some extent, and I say in the last 10, 15 years, people of color have become eroticized in the culture. And so now it's sort of hip and chic to be a person of color, kind of, in some circles. And I'm very aware that a lot of the times I'm asked to do things simply because I'm a Native woman. Not, you know, and so I have a whole bunch of conflict. Am I a good writer? I really question every morning, am I any good as a writer, or am I just a token being plugged into the token machine? And that's a very painful question to deal with. And I don't know if I'll ever kind of come to an answer about that. But I really suggest that you find ways to become involved politically in Indian struggles. There's stuff going on everywhere. I don't know what's happening particularly in Boston, but I'm sure that there's a nation fairly close by that is having their fishing rights taken away, their land taken away, their cemetery turned into a golf course. I mean, you know, it's like it's everywhere. And when you become involved in that political work and see the real life and death struggle that Native people are involved in, it's sort of like your own pain becomes, you know, it's like, well, why focus on that, you know, because there's all this real work that needs to be done. There's still so much invisibility in this country. So many people have said to me, oh, I thought all Indians were dead. You know, and they're very sincere. They're not mean. They're just saying that, you know, and that's what they think. I mean, all of us. I mean, I grew up watching Indians being killed on TV just like everybody else did, you know. And I heard all the myths about how Columbus discovered America. I was 38 years old before I figured out that Columbus did not discover America. So, you know, even though I knew who I was and all of that kind of stuff, you know, that junk just embeds itself in your brain, and you don't even know how to go into your brain and get it out. Although I think that that kind of excavation process is how we can heal from our pain. It's like the more garbage we can get out of our head, the less pain we feel about that whole situation. And one of the things that I always try to remember is that the African people who are in this country suffer more than the Native people, from my point of view, in the fact that they don't have their languages. They don't know who their nations were. It's like, even though I have all this suffering and all this struggling, I still know I'm a nominee. I know words in my language. I know what we did. I know our stories. I know how we created the world. I know all of those things. And for African people who were brought here, all of that was stripped away. And that's a kind of pain that I think is overwhelming, because identity is central to our ability to write. You know, it's like when you grasp your identity firmly, then you have a voice to speak from. So anyway, I could rant a lot.
Jackie?
Quickly.
Well, I do something pretty tricky. We believe in, you know, in our cultures, we believe that you can transform people into whatever you want them to be. So when I perform for an audience, I just make them all into radical lesbian feminist women of color. And I just let it go. And sometimes I'll even joke with the audience and say, I'm about to read lesbian erotica. You'll all be lesbians for a little while, but don't worry, you know, it won't stick unless you want it to. You know, it's like... or, you know, because for a while I was in a place where I wouldn't read erotica to mixed audiences. And then I discovered that meant that all the lesbians in the audience would come up to me afterwards and say, you didn't read any erotica, I'm mad at you. And it's like, because actually we have never controlled our audiences. Never, never, never. Our audiences have always been whoever shows up, whoever has the time, whoever doesn't have to do their laundry. You know, it's kind of that way. And so what you have to do is literally in your mind make your audience into who you want them to be, right? And expect from your audience that they will understand everything you're going to say, that there's no problem of communication, that you're not a mystery, that you're not a weirdo. It's sort of like you give the audience the gift of seeing them as your peers. And when you make the audience into your peers, it's amazing to me how much people will rise to the occasion, because most people don't use very much of their brain cells, you know. And so what I do is I just kind of make everybody into a lesbian, or, you know, and it's helped a lot, because there was a point when I was performing when I would get inundated at the end of things with questions like, why do you hate white people, and, you know, all that tiresome stuff. Since I have started just making them into people that I can talk to, it's sort of like they're too embarrassed to not be someone that I can talk to, right? So that's the way that I do it. The other thing about performing is that when you come into the performance space, you need to center yourself in the four directions. So you cast out, you know, like power lines to the four directions and make sure that you're centered. And in that way, you aren't making yourself vulnerable to an audience, because sometimes they can be kind of dead, or, you know, I mean, audiences are so quixotic, you know. They're kind of like menopause, you know. Sometimes they're hot, and sometimes they're like crabby, and sometimes, you know. And I, one of the other tricks I use is I often tell a funny story before I begin reading, or tell a joke, or read a funny poem, because what happens is when people laugh, they give up their stuff. You know, they kind of laugh, and then it's like it's okay, and, you know, so it's always good to make up funny stories, even if they're not true, you know. So, is that good?
Like what? Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, right. Yeah, right. I was just wondering which one. I mean, you were talking about specific. You know, where they're coming from, depending upon, you know, the place, the venue. I do, like Chrystos, assume everyone is my peer. But I use my own level of comfort to help me decide what I'm going to read, because there's some things I would be uncomfortable reading in front of certain audiences. Well, like, you know.
Yeah, I don't read erotica to Native American audiences.
And people have asked me why I don't read erotica to Native American audiences, and I've had to explain that we have a very different cultural way of being sexual, so that heterosexual Native people don't write erotica, okay? It doesn't exist. There is no erotica that is heterosexual, and we don't hold hands in public and kiss in public. Like, there's a very, it's sort of like sex is considered very private. And so, like, I'm way out there in my community. It's like I'm really, I have to tone myself way down when I do an Indian event. And so it's just not appropriate for me to do erotica in that audience. So, and sometimes, you know, you always need to check an audience out. You know, sometimes I don't decide what I'm going to read until I get right up there and look around and see who's there. And I mean, if it's an audience that's 90% women of color, you know, I can have a good time rather than having to do, you know, I am not your princess, you know, and ranting and raving, you know, because although sometimes that's actually one of the more popular poems with women of color. They really like that one, so I end up reading it a lot. But so your audience is always, I mean, one of the things I really like about Chinese and Japanese concepts of art is that they talk about that you are only half of the picture, and the audience and who views it is the other half of the picture. So you need in your work and in your performance to leave room for that other half of the picture. So I usually try when I'm writing to leave a lot of space for other, you know, for the response from someone else. So that, you know, because it's very easy as a writer to hog the space, you know, just blah, take it all up. And it's hard to keep your ego in check.
But I also try to, you know, if I feel that I'm in an audience outside of one that, you know, outside the lesbian feminist audience, I do try to read at least one piece that I might perceive as risky, you know, just to do it. But also, I guess to educate also, which is, I think, another important part of our writing over these years has been, you know, the, one of the purposes has been to educate audiences about ourselves. So, are there other questions?
Because I really need to do my Norma Jean Croy bit.
Yes.
Okay, it'll be quick.
Okay. Norma Jean Croy is a lesbian Native woman, prisoner of war in Chowchilla. Her brother Hootie was freed on the same charges a while ago as self-defense. And how the U.S. Injustice system works is that if you're on death row, you have access to appeals automatically. Now, Hootie was on death row, which is why he is free. Norma Jean was not on death row, and so she doesn't have access to the same legal framework. The other part of it is that people of color and women always do 2 to 3 times more time than other prisoners. The prison system is extremely sexist. They will deny most lesbians parole because they have not reformed, because part of the prison system is still the idea that a woman should not be leaving the prison as a lesbian. So they're still enforced drugging and putting lesbians in the hole and, you know, all kinds of stuff like that. Norma Jean has done 14 years of time for slugging a white man clerk in a convenience store. Dan White did 7 years for killing 2 politicians. So that tells you something of kind of what the racism that we're dealing with. So at the press gang table, which is in the mezzanine, I have petitions for Norma Jean Croy's release because we're trying to embarrass the government into releasing her, which is also what we're up to with Leonard Peltier. I hope you've all written letters to Clinton about him. And there's a donation basket. And I'm going to go over there now to sign books. So I would appreciate it if you would. I think there's some pamphlets left. I can't see where Barbara is, about Norma Jean. And if you want to start up a Boston chapter here, I would be really happy because I'm the board of directors person who's supposed to get chapters everywhere. We have 2 people on the board of directors, which tells you. Okay, that's it.
This concludes the National Lesbian and Gay Writers Conference, held October 8th through the 10th, 1993, in Boston, Massachusetts. This session was recorded live and on location by Conference Recording Service of Berkeley, California. For more information on other tapes in this series, please call 510-527-3600. Thank you for listening.